Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing this potentially rainy day? It's good to be able to gather together and worship, to be able to come and to sing God's praises, and to experience the joy of coming together as the people of God. So as we gather today, there are a few announcements. One of them is about the tarts. St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church in Elma is having their third annual Tarts Galore Festival, and the organizers have invited St. Andrew's, Arthur, and Gordonville to participate. And the information is there. I believe a number of people have been talked to about tarts. So that's coming up next Saturday. So
if you're not. We hope to see people there. We're having some tarts, so get your money ready.
So, yep, there's tarts being made, and everyone's invited to come and, I'd say sample, but I think the idea is to buy.
Yes.
So, those are the announcements for this morning. I invite us to turn our attention to our responsive call to worship, which comes from Psalm 30. I will exalt you, Lord, for you lift me out of the depths and did not let my enemies gloat over me.
Lord my God, I call to you for help, and you hear me.
You, Lord, brought me up from the realm of the dead. You spared me from going down to the pit.
Sing the praises of the Lord, you his faithful people, praise his holy name.
For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may stay for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning.
When I felt secure, I said, I will never be shaken.
Lord, when you favored me, you made my royal mountain stand firm. But when you hid your face, I was dismayed. To you, Lord, I called. To the Lord I cried for mercy. What is gained if I am silenced? If I go down to the pit, will the dust praise you? Will it proclaim your faithfulness? Hear, Lord, and be merciful to me. Lord, be my help. You turn my wailing into dancing. You remove my sackcloth and clothe me with joy, that my heart may sing your praises. And not be silent. Lord my God, I will praise you forever. I invite us to join together as we sing, Morning Has Broken.
Sprung in completeness. Thank you. shall they do? For our lives but just begun, for the great gift of thy Son.
Kids, and I'm just going to let us watch, and we'll go from there.
Stories of the Bible. Jesus forgives Peter. This is Peter.
Hello.
Peter was a fisherman who was called by Jesus.
Hey.
Peter saw the many miracles of Jesus, and he heard all of his teachings. When the time came for Jesus to die and take away the sins of all the world, Jesus had one final meal with his friends. During this meal, Jesus told his followers that the time had come for him to leave them. Peter asked, "Where are you going?" Jesus told him Peter couldn't follow him now.
What?
But that he would follow him later.
Whatever.
But Peter said, "Why can't I come now? I'm ready to die for you." Jesus said, "Die for me? Peter, before the rooster crows tomorrow morning, you will deny three times that you even knew me." Then Jesus and his disciples went to the Mount of Olives so Jesus could pray. Along the way, Jesus told his followers that they would all abandon him. But Peter said, "Even if everyone else leaves you, I never will." Jesus said, "Peter, this very night, before the rooster crows, you will deny three times that you even know me." But Peter wouldn't believe it and vowed that he would stay with Jesus until the very end. The other disciples vowed the same.
Yeah, I'm good.
Later on that night, Jesus was arrested by men sent by the religious teachers and priests. Peter tried to fight for Jesus, and he cut off the ear of one of the guards. But Jesus healed the guard and went quietly with the captors. All the disciples scattered just as Jesus told them they would. The men led Jesus away to the house of the high priest. Peter and another disciple followed them. Peter came to warm himself by their fire. A servant girl noticed him in the firelight. Finally, she said, "This man was one of Jesus' followers." But Peter denied it for the first time. He said, "I don't even know him." After a while, someone else looked at him and said, "You must be one of them." Peter, for a second time, said, "No, I'm not." About an hour later, a man who knew the man whose ear Peter cut off said, "Didn't I see you in the olive grove with Jesus? This must be one of them. He comes from the same place as all of them."
"Yeah, you're right."
But Peter said,
No.
"I don't know what you're talking about." And then Peter heard the crow of the rooster. Jesus turned and looked at Peter. Jesus' words flashed through his mind, and Peter left the courtyard weeping. Then Jesus died and was placed in a tomb. The disciples heard that he had come back from the dead. Peter even saw the empty tomb and believed that Jesus was alive again.
Woo-hoo!
And Jesus appeared to the disciples to show him that he was alive. Some of Jesus' followers were together when Peter said, "I am going fishing."
Amen.
So they all went out to the sea, but caught nothing all night. At dawn, they saw a man standing on the beach.
Over there.
The man called out to them and said, "Have you bed, one of the men on the boat said to Peter, "It's Jesus." When Peter heard that it was Jesus, he swam to the shore while the others pulled in the load to the boat. When they got there, they found breakfast waiting for them.
Breakfast, man. Got it.
Jesus said, "Come have some breakfast." While they were eating, Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" Peter said, "Yes, you know I love you." So Jesus said, "Then feed my lambs." Then Jesus asked again, "Do you love me?" Peter said again, "Yes, you know I love you." And Jesus said, "Then take care of my sheep." And then a third time, Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" Peter was hurt that Jesus asked the question a third time. So he said, "You know everything. You know that I love you." So Jesus said one last time, "Then feed my sheep." And so Peter went on to feed Jesus' sheep by helping establish the church and by writing books that we can now read in the Bible. And though he denied Jesus, he was forgiven, and many came to know the love and forgiveness of Jesus through Peter.
When we think of Peter, Peter was one of Jesus' disciples. And I like to say, sometimes Peter knew exactly what to say and did exactly what he was supposed to, and sometimes he didn't. And this video, it reminds us that even those times when Peter didn't do what he said he was going to do, even those times when Peter was afraid, Jesus still was there, and he forgave Peter, as Jesus forgives each of us. Because sometimes we too sin, sometimes we do as Peter does, we deny Jesus, we forget about Jesus in our everyday lives, but Jesus never forgets about us, and he makes a way for us to be able to come to him, to know him, and to be welcomed by him, to be loved by him. So I invite us to come before the Lord in prayer. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you. We thank you that you never forget us, but you always forgive us. Lord, help us to forgive others as you forgive us. Help us to not sin, but also when we do sin, help us to know how to make things right, to be honest, to ask for forgiveness, to help us to change our ways, and to be the people that you have created us to be, people that you have redeemed us to be. Lord, we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. All righty. Have fun downstairs. Times of recreation. times of learning. Lord, help us to focus on you. Help us to leave the worries of the world behind us and to be able to hear your word. To hear your word as you speak into our lives and into the struggles that we face, whether it is health problems, whether it's problems in relationships, problems at work, problems understanding the whys that never truly make sense. Help us to trust you, who are faithful, who has been faithful through all generations, who has been faithful through all the years of our lives. Lord, help us to hear your word. May your Holy Spirit break down the problems that bind our ears, that cover our eyes. Help us to truly hear what you would have us hear, not just what we want to. Challenge us, Lord. Transform us to live as the people you have called us to be. We pray this in Jesus Christ's name. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Acts chapter 9, verses 1 to 20, and from the Gospel of John chapter 21, verses 1 to 19. And in both, there is a confronting of who Jesus really is. Meanwhile, Saul, who we later know as Paul, was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias." "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priests to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings, and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. At once he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. From the Gospel of John. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I am going out to fish," Simon Peter told them. And they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out and got in the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals with fish on it, and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said. "You know that I love you," Jesus said. "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." It's an interesting question. How does sight change your faith? How has sight changed your faith? We don't have the same privilege as Saul or Paul or Peter, and how that has changed our faith. Sometimes when it comes to faith, it is like you've poured out a box of puzzle pieces, and it's all jumbled up. And it takes a while for us to figure out exactly what it all looks like, what it all means. And we try to make sense of it, we try to put the pieces together, and sometimes we struggle to make sense of what is going on. Sometimes it takes a while for us to fit all the pieces of faith together. Now, for this puzzle that you're watching on the screen here, it has sort of a time lapse. It goes a lot faster than if I was doing it. Because I get impatient with large, thousand-piece puzzles. I like doing them with someone else for the sake of doing it with someone else. I like going fishing with my brother, not because I particularly like going fishing. I like casting the rod. I didn't like touching the fish. But I love spending time with my brother. Faith takes time. It takes time of spending time with Jesus, spending time with the Holy Spirit, spending time in God's Word, so that as we continue to walk with Christ, as we continue to grow in faith, as we continue to understand and make sense of the puzzle of faith, as it starts to come into clarity, as the pieces start to fit in a clearer sense, we start to have a deeper understanding of what is before us. Now, as much as I'd love to let us keep watching this, I'm not going to. Understanding how the picture fits together can be difficult. It can be hard, it can take time, it can cause us to really struggle with what is going on. And as we think about the different things of our faith, sometimes we know up here, we know the stories, we know what has happened, we know parts of the whys, but we struggle with our hearts. And other times, sometimes our heart is in the right place, but we don't understand quite or what is right in front of us. And in the two scripture readings that we have today, we have Paul or Saul, and then we have Peter. Both of them, and I'd say they both struggled fitting all the pieces of faith together. Peter, more than anyone else, had that head knowledge, but his heart had been hurt. He did not trust himself because he had declared, "I will never leave you, I will never deny you." And Jesus is going, "You're going to deny me at least three times. You're going to deny me three times before the rooster crows." And Peter says, "Never." And then he does. And Saul has a great love for God. A huge love for God. He doesn't want anyone to be blaspheming against God. He is willing to leave what he knows and go in the name of God to round up people who are blaspheming in his idea of what is happening. That they are leading people astray, that Jesus has led people astray. So we have these two people that are struggling. That are struggling to make sense of what is before them, what they have seen, what they have experienced, what life has brought into their midst, what God has revealed to them. Sometimes we are like that. Sometimes we know a great deal, but we struggle to have faith. Sometimes we want to do all that God wants us to do, but we're doing it for all the wrong reasons. Sometimes we can be like Peter. Sometimes we can be like Paul. And we struggle to make sense of the faith that is before us. And it is important to understand the full picture of faith. To make that, and to change not just this from the story, not just from the understanding, not just from the head knowledge, but also to have the heart and the belief and the faith to go along with it. Not just having the faith, the blind faith, but to know why we are having this faith, why this faith is important. To know what God has done and is continuing to do. When we start to see the full picture of what God has unfolded before us of Jesus Christ, and through the Word, we are confronted with a reality that is very hard to deny. Don't get me wrong, people try to all the time. We run into that all the time. Sometimes we even run into ourselves trying to deny it. But for Peter, that healing of the heart, Jesus had to confront the denial. Three times Peter denied knowing Christ. Three times Peter had denied his mentor, his friend,
the one he was willing to die for, and suddenly he wasn't. And Jesus confronts that denial. He confronts it head on. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord. And feed my sheep, or feed my lambs. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord. And take care of my sheep. And the third time, Peter, do you love me? And it's interesting that scriptures say at this particular point that Peter is sad. Because Jesus asked him the third time. Not just the first time. Not the second time, but the third time. Peter is saddened that Jesus is going down this road. And in all of this, Jesus is giving Peter a second chance. A second chance to follow. Second chance to partake in the ministry that Jesus had given to Peter and was still giving to Peter. And then there's Saul. Saul with a heart for God, but not being able to make sense of what Jesus had been doing and what Jesus had done. So Jesus confronts Saul on the road to Damascus, on the path to further persecution. And again, cuts right to the heart of the matter. Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? And Saul gives a common response, whether it was a recognition of Jesus as Lord, or whether Saul is just saying so out of respect. Who are you, Lord? It is I, Jesus, the one who you are persecuting. And in that instance, Saul is confronted with a clear picture of what had been going on. What he couldn't see and what he couldn't put into place. That Jesus truly was Lord. Not just in the respectful way, but in the divine reality that was standing before him. Are we willing to see clearly the pieces that God has placed before us? To be able to see the picture of faith that God is calling us to. And when we start to do this, and it took Saul 3 days of fasting, of praying, of another disciple having to get over his own fear. Imagine that. Even in faith, there is fear. And in that moment, that disciple, Ananias, gets over his own fear, still being faithful, and goes and visits Saul. Instead of Saul coming to arrest the fellow believers, he becomes one and starts preaching the good news. Saul, who was a trained Pharisee, trained in the scriptures, trained in speaking, starts proclaiming the one he came to destroy. It was something that many of the people who heard were astounded. Imagine that. Someone that they fear is now one of their biggest opponents. One of the ones that is speaking the loudest, one of the ones that is speaking in spheres and in ways that the others could not. As the Lord was speaking through them. Being able to see, being confronted with the Lord and with that, the one that we seek to follow and to honor, being confronted with the reality that is before us, and to be able to see more clearly, to be able to put the pieces of the puzzle of faith together, that it makes sense, or begins to make sense. Because as you all know, if you've ever done a puzzle, especially a 1,000-piece puzzle, I like the 4-piece puzzles. Very quick, don't have to worry about patience. They all fit in eventually. My problem with the 1,000-piece puzzle is I can make pieces fit that don't fit together. And that's not good. Because then you get a distorted picture. God wants us to have that clear picture so that we understand and can draw closer and can trust and can have faith. Knowing the gospel and knowing God's grace in Jesus Christ is different, because we can know things, but have we received? You can know that there is a present for you, sometimes we even know what that present is, but until we receive it, there's always something missing. There's that disconnect. It's not fully ours until we receive it, until we take it, until we accept it. It is the same with the gift that God has given us in His grace and His forgiveness. It is there for us. He has given it to us through Jesus Christ. But until we receive it, we don't understand the fullness of it. We don't experience the fullness of His love. We don't experience the fullness of His grace, of His forgiveness, and how that will continue to change our lives. We all need to be willing to meet with Jesus and receive His love and His purpose for our lives. He did this for both Peter and Saul. That Peter was to care for the people that Jesus was giving to him. That Saul would proclaim the good news to the Gentiles. And by the way, if you forgot, it wasn't going to be an easy trip. Jesus says to Ananias, and he will find out how much he will suffer. The good news doesn't mean that life is going to be easy. But it does mean that we are never alone. That God is leading us forward. That God is present even in these times of struggle. That sometimes the things that God asks us to do and calls us to do and empowers us to do is not easy. It was not easy for Peter or for Saul to be confronted with the realities of the struggles that they faced with their faith. But Jesus didn't shy away from that. He met both of them head on. But they would both have a clear understanding of their faith, of Jesus Himself. I invite us to join together as we sing, Jesus, Lover of My Soul.
Lover of my soul. receive my soul at last. Other refuge have I none. Take my helpless soul on thee. Leave me not alone. Still support and comfort.
My Savior all the day long. This is my story.
my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
May we go today as people, seeing the light of faith, and the fullness of the picture of God painting before us. May we walk in faith. May we speak the words of faith. May we share the glory of God, the life of the last. May we go in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Go in love, have no fear. God will guide you. He is always. God will hear you, He will understand. May His light forever shine upon you. May His peace be always in your heart. Go in love, face each day. God will lead you.
Blessing go with you. May you walk with Him each day of your of the week. Until next time, be at peace with God, with each other, and with yourself.